This is Wang Weizhong, a well-known TV producer in China. He was born and educated on the island of Taiwan. Wang began his career in the TV industry as an intern at the age of 19. By 24, he was already a producer. People have called Wang Weizhong as the godfather of variety television in Taiwan. His creations have become instant hits on both the Chinese mainland as well as Taiwan. Others regard him as a legendary magician who can turn an ordinary artist into a superstar. As the digital era continues to develop, the production and promotion of TV programs are gradually changing. Join us on this week's program to find out Wang Weizhong's insights into a rapidly evolving sector.
Wang Weizhong.
Oh, yeah, Steve.
谢谢参加我们的节目.
No problem.
Yeah.
You're a very handsome guy.
Thank you, as
Double
are
seven,
you. 谢谢。今天有可能你第一次有一个外国人用中文采访你。
对对对对对对，讲得非常好。哪里哪里哪里，还不行。
Mr. Wang, I've read from previous interviews that your acumen for what the audience wants actually started at a very young age. In the military housing, you grew up in a military dependence village. Okay, for a lot of us in the West, we know what that is. It's usually barracks of a military where a lot of kids play together. And I heard that one of the benefits of where you grew up is many people came from all over China, and so you were able to even imitate accents from different regions in China, and you understood what made them laugh or what people wanted. So let me take you back to those years right now. Imagine when you were 3 years old to 8 years old, you're playing with your friends. What did you learn from those different regions and those different friends?
我觉得环境是决定一个人的一生，尤其是如果你是一个比较 sentimental 的人，你对感情的事情非常敏感。有些人天生就对感情的事情比较敏感，这感情包括亲情、爱情、友情等等等等。从事这种影视工作或者 art 工作人，本来就对感情东西比较敏感。然后我的父母1949年从大陆迁移到台湾之后，跟着国民党部队，我们就住在就是你们我们讲眷村了。
Wang Weizhong was born into a military village in Jiayi, Taiwan province. A military dependence village is housing specifically built for Kuomintang troops and their dependents who moved from the Chinese mainland to Taiwan between 1949 to 1960. After 1960, the influx began to dwindle, but the talented children who grew up there subsequently became the highlight of emerging Taiwanese pop culture. For example, in the film industry, Ang Wei, Ho Xiaoxian, and Bridget Lin. In musical performance, Teresa Tung, Tom Zhang, and Cai Qing. In the TV industry, Wang Weizhong, Sally Wu, and Gao Lingfeng. In literature, Long Mingtai. And in business, Guo Taiming. So how did life in the military villages shape these people?
我们那个环境有2000多个家庭，那都是来自中国大陆各个省的，啊，都有居住在一起。我小时候有开始记忆开始还这么小，可是我天生就很 sentimental， 我就在那个环境里面，巷子都很窄，2000多户，我至少就是几十户人家一样跑来跑去。如果你要做一个 drama， 就看一个小孩子一直在跑，跑到这家。 跟这家大人聊聊天，吃吃东西，又跑那家，去跟那家人玩一玩，等等，就每天都这样子玩，所以我就非常丰富，我的 accents 或者各方面，我对大人、年轻人、小孩子，我就非常丰富，我就像一个 sponge 一样，吸收了非常多的感情，然后像个中国人最喜欢的大家庭，啊，当然这个家庭看起来比较破，但是它很一样啊，它是没有。 他没有前门，也没有后院，他就是每天这样子一直在玩。对大人来讲，他可能是一个像一个难民营，因为他是 refugee 一样，他到一个地方来。对我来讲，就是一个 what Disneyland， 然后就每一天在这样玩，所以那个东西对我来讲太重要了。我们中国人讲人情世故，学习太多太多东西，这些东西对我又很，我又是个敏感的人，所以对我以后做任何的创作。 做戏剧也好，做综艺也好，做舞台剧也好，是我用不完的 treasure。
虽然这房子破的这个样子啊，又进水又淹水，可是它总是我住了50多年的家呀。
当初拍这个纪录片的原因也很简单，因为我太怀念我的家乡。最好玩的就是那个时候眷村的姐姐啊哥哥长大的时候，带男的朋友或女朋友回来的时候，眷村妈妈都会在这个地方，然后看他们俩走进来就不讲话，然后走过之后再张家长李家短，非常非常让我怀念的地方。
Since the drama 光阴的故事 was launched in 2008,Wang Weizhong has produced a series of masterpieces on the military village, including books, a documentary, and a stage play called The Village with the director Stan Lai.
I imagine you had a lot of friends in that village, you know, living alongside, playing with you, but you were different. You know, you're able to absorb these stories and to see what makes people laugh, what makes people cry.Is this, do you think, nature or nurture? Was this something inborn?
我们中国人家庭呢，中国人家庭里面，父亲、母亲，尤其父亲比较严肃。可是我们家不一样，我的父亲是一个 comedian， 他很有趣。我妈妈还比较严格，可是也很有趣。我们家里面是允许小孩子说话的。中国人家庭里面通常说小孩子不要闭嘴，不能讲话。You're still young.像这样，可是我们家庭里面，我在眷村的家庭里面，我们家又比较特别，因为我爸爸跟我妈在整个眷村里面属于比较年轻的，我妈16岁就生我的大姐，我爸爸那时候才19岁不到20岁，所以两个像 teenager 一样，从大陆就来到台湾，组织一个小家庭，好像办嘎嘎酒，两个 teenager 一个二十不到，一个15、16岁，所以他们非常。非常天真 naive， 就做一个家庭，所以他们的教育模式对我们也很像朋友，这个在中国人家庭比较少，我们非常 open minded， 啊，非常 outgoing， 然后我们是老北京人，老北京人可能会说笑话，啊，所以很有趣。如果那个时候有 reality show， 我们家基本上就是一个 totally。Sitcoms.
Yeah, just turn on the cameras. It's so great content, right?
Yeah, 我们可以坐在一桌上一直讲话等等。所以那个帮助我的个性，虽然家里很破，但是我是个快乐家庭。所以快乐家庭对一个人是非常重要。
Let's go back to your childhood with one more question here. And a lot of people in our audience, people have sent me questions. They want to know if you were naughty when you were young.
我很调皮，但是我有安静的一面。我小时候很皮，哦。但是呢，我妈妈如果给我一个黑板，我不会画画，但是我天生会画，我没有学过，我天生会画卡通，我一个有个黑板，我就可以一整个下午，太阳很大，那个树的 shadow 这样过来的时候，我就在下面我可以画一下午 storyboard， 我自己在 image。
You even started at a young age. Yes, yes.
对
，visualizing your stories, right?
Wang Weizhong was born with a keen imagination. When he was applying for university, his mother wanted him to major in science because that degree would offer him more career choices after graduation. However, without any hesitation, Wang Weizhong chose the news and media faculty of the Chinese Culture University.
在我们那个时代，电视这个 box 是 Wonderland,
the highest,
very high. 一个眷村里面2000多户家庭。大概只有几台电视，所以我们小时候都像看电影一样，要跑到人家家里面去看电视。我们眷村有一个大姐，她是读新闻的，她后来到电视台去做主播。啊 ，Jesus Christ， 不可思议！她回到我们村子的时候，万人空巷，大家都要去看这个大姐。我那时候觉得，她爸爸妈妈就很骄傲，眼睛好像长到这里来了。那时候呢，我看到。我很 touch， 因为我们家里很穷，我希望有一天我的父母一样 proud。
Since his second year at university, Wang Weizhong started his internships at the TV stations because he felt great pressure to bring glory to his family. At the age of 24, he became a producer. To some, it seems that he was very lucky. However, I believe his success is attributed to his hard working and persistence. For example, once he had been working in the studio for 4 days straight without any sleep. When he finally walked out of the studio at the TV station, he saw the sunset in Taipei. He sat on the stairs and he could not help but to cry. And another time, he worked at the Taipei Filming Company to learn the film developing process. For days on end, he was soaked in chemicals and fumes in the workshop. When other interns could take it no longer, and they quit, Wang Weizhong survived until the end.
其实我现在回忆，我那个时候想做 director。我们电视叫导播嘛，因为那个时候我觉得一个导播是大于演员、大于目前的人的，啊，我想做导播，可是也搞不清楚。那后来就反正就慢慢越做，就做了电视工作，做到电视工作，我现在也做电影，做的影视工作做这么多年。 我才慢慢体会我应该是做一个什么样的人，还大概有点了解了。可是岁月已经过了快40天了。
In 1979, local TV stations in Taiwan began to outsource their programs. Since then, there were diverse variety shows. The outsourcing of TV show production brought Wang Weizhong an opportunity to show his capabilities. So in 1977, he stepped into the TV industry. His career path of more than 30 years is basically the prosperous era of Taiwanese variety shows. The TV shows he produced included daily news, talk shows, talent shows, and others. One of the talk shows called Kang Qi is very popular among audiences in the Chinese mainland.
Well, let's use your show Kang Qi as an example. Can you talk about the profit model of that show? Where does the money come from and how is it distributed generally?
台湾的 cable TV 有线电视，它的尺度比较宽，啊，它不会像 free TV 这种比较窄，它尺度比较宽。第一个，第二个它 cost 比较低。How
is that? How is the cost? 哦
，cost。台湾这么点小地方，3.6万方公里，啊，2300万人，它有100多个电视台，100多个 cable。哦，所以它因为就我们中国人讲说增多粥少。 就是那个庙里面和尚很多，可是吃的食物很少，所以成本就会低，很清楚。在这种情况之下，我们必须要用非常 smart 的方法去做一个 variety show。那么一个电视节目，我认为最重要的还是人。For example， 像一个访谈节目，最重要的还是谁在做这个 host， 谁被接受 interview。若人有趣，你不需要太多的道具，不需要太多的。 东西去唱歌啊、跳啊，人就好玩，所以我们必须要用我们的脑子瓜去想，去投资一些有趣的主持人来做 talk show， 啊，然后让那个节目比较好看。Kang
Qi started broadcasting in 2004. It has been 9 years since its premiere, and it is a variety show with the highest ratings on a Taiwanese cable TV station. In December 2012, Tencent bought the online exclusive broadcasting rights of Kang Qi. The broadcasting volume of the first season of Kang Qi, 2013, has broken through 300 million. The two hosts, Cai Kongyong and Xiao S, are paired strategically. One is knowledgeable, and the other one has a sense of humor. This unique cooperation method, as well as sharp and interesting topics, are the secrets of success for Kang Qi. However, many people criticize the host's outrageous behavior.
在东方的文化里面，主持人 host 还是希望能够赢得尊敬，赢得别人的 respect。可是，其实我认为好的主持人能够赢得别人喜欢你就已经很棒了，不见得要赢得别人尊敬，因为。 主持人好像在家里面做客一样，比如说你是一个 father， 是家里的 host， 然后很多小朋友、你的孩子的同学来家里玩，他们很多同学来你家里玩，你就是好的父亲，因为你给人家感觉，哎呀，来来来，东西扔到地上干嘛也没关系啊，就是好的父亲。
如果你那人家都不想来你家里玩，你就不是好的 host。
Founded in 1979, Gene Star Entertainment is led by Wang Weizhong. Its predecessor was the famous Taiwanese production firm, Fulong Production. It is one of the production companies that has been in existence the longest, so it also has the most experience. Gene Star Entertainment mainly focuses on TV show production, artist management, big events, and other large-scale projects.
Gene Star Entertainment, what is your business model for this? Are you a content provider for TV stations?
对，我们是 content provider， 但是我们不光是做电视，我们也投资电影，我们也做一些文化创作，我们也做舞台剧，我们也培养艺人，我们也做一些training 的学校，培养明星，我们做很多跟别人合作很多东西，这样子。对。
Where's the greatest profit coming from which segment?
培养出的艺人 talent。他去做很多很多的活动，啊，然后都是 connect 了，都是关联性的东西。因为你做电视节目、做戏剧、做综艺，然后培养艺人，艺人可以做活动，活动可以代言，它是整体的一个 chain， 要这样互相勾住的这样子。
Tell me how when you do production for a TV station, do you usually do two or three pilot shows, or do you create a whole series that's already sold?I think some of our audience members understand the Asian market, which is quite different from the Western model. In the West, you sample, you do two, three shows. If you get great ratings, if people like it, you keep going. You get the funding for it. But if people don't like it, you cut it. Huanga, you know, bring in another. But what about your company? Do you usually do two or three shows, or do you create a whole series or a whole film, or how does it work?
我们有一些是做 pilot, 要给别人看。有一些我们就直接把我们的案子就是我们的 plan 提供给电视台，可能我们做久了电视台对我们比较相信，就是 you go ahead 可以这样去做，有些是要做 pilot。
Gene Star Entertainment, tell me what you're going to focus on in the next 10 or 20 years.
以前我们做 producer 比较简单，你只知道如何做 content， 如何做 performance， 把你的 content performance 表现出来就好。但是这个时代现在是 digital 的时代，是很多东西要 cloud 要上云的，所以现在一个制作人我觉得已经不太像只是一个简单的 producer， 应该像一个英文要叫 curator， 像个你比如说你要做一个电视节目，比如说我们做一个访谈节目，一个 interview 节目，除了这些人我们要你用一个访问的方式来做一些访问内容之外，然后包括我们今天是不是有些东西可以在有一个社群网站，大家可以先讨论说，哎，我们要问这个人什么问题？基本上它不是一个光是一个很简单的一个电视节目，它要像一个数位时代，它这东西可不可以上云？这些资料可不可以临时找出来或等等？它有很多很多的因素存在。我们的工作人员要训练自己有数位时代的概念，它就不光是做一个电视，它要跟 Internet， 它想到 Internet 上怎么做 ，Smart TV 上怎么做 ，Merchandise 要不要做一些商品，要不要做一些 Interactive。互动的一些这种所谓的社群网站，它不光是一个制作人，而我认为一个好的制作人以后要努力做好一件事情，把它做得很多重，我觉得是好的。所以培养制作人的观念还是非常重要的事情。
So what you're saying then is match the content with the audience.And in the past, perhaps it was simpler. We only had a few TV channels, and we had a lot of people watching at night from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. or 10 p.m. So it was easier then, but now it's getting harder because we do have more outlets. We have 100 TV channels, or we have 600 TV channels in America. I know I sit there, you could spend an hour just flipping through all the channels, and an hour or two have passed. And now we have digital content as well on tablets and on mobile phones. So that's what you're saying, then you're going to create more specialized content for specialized audiences.
对，我觉得电视节目以后可能是 free charge 的，不要钱的。
Everything.
Yeah, 我觉得 content 以后是 free charge 不要钱的，可是这 content 本身它能够发展出多少东西，就像最近的 Opera Show 它已经不是在做一个电视节目了，它在做一个 platform， 你们大家都可以去看，不要钱看也可以把它 download 下来传给任何人，但它里面的一些内容它要买一些，它有些东西要变成课程你就要去pay了，所以它这个我觉得很多电视节目已经以后只是变成一个 promotion 的一个平台而已。 那在这个节目里面本身有很多东西你必须要再付钱去买，然后甚至一个电视节目，现在很多电视节目很多 drama 在看的过程中它有个 QR code， 这个 actor 或 actress 穿的衣服你可以直接购买了啊，然后也不光是做 couch potato 看电视，你可以从手机看到任何地方可以看，可以做任何东西。你有看 NBA 篮球赛，也不光是看一个 NBA， 你在里面可以买很多 merchandise， 也可以买下面的机票，也可以参加他们的 conference， 就有很多东西了。以后这个东西都会，就是全部都会在你的 smart cell phone 里面可以解决所有的事情。一个 producer 是一定要懂你的 device， 你这些数位的 device 怎么用，就是已经很复杂了，比我们那时候做电视要复杂太多了。
A lot of your co-workers, a lot of people who've worked with you say that you're quite serious, but you're comedic as well, and it's unusual to find someone in this industry with both sides. And to me, you seem more like a director, not a producer. You know, the director is the one that watches a 30-second commercial and is in tears afterwards, you know, is moved by the emotion or sees the emotive element of the situation, whereas the producer looks at the bottom line. The producer says, okay, how much money are we going to make? Yes, we can do that. No, we can't do that. And of course, it's inverted in the West and the East. In the West, we have the director giving the commands, the producer following suit. But in Asia, the producer gives the command and the director follows suit. So how do you work with your directors? Tell me about that dynamic.
这是个好问题，应该这样讲，就是说，其实 producer 有很多种啊，有比较像导演的 producer， 有点有人比较像这种 finance controller 这样子的 producer。Right. 但是我觉得你的概念是对的。其实 producer 应该 above everything， 就是他应该管 budget， 应该做 relationship promotion 各方面来讲。我不认为我是一个非常好的 producer。我可能是一个很好的 creator， 很好的 director 啊，等等等等。所以呢，我现在我的 partner 就是我的 vice president， 他比较像好的 producer 跟老板。我到六十岁，快六十岁，我才知道说，哦，我不是一个好的 boss， 但是我是一个好的 creator 或 director， 基本我是一个好的一个 comedian， 我是个 artist。可是我那个时候做 production house 的时候，我必须要赚钱。所以让我自己变成一个 producer 跟一个 boss 一个老板，或者是我应该找一个很好的 partner 一起来合作。我现在发觉我那个 partner 比我像小我十几岁，他比较像老板，所以我现在他应该赚的比我多。我接受 I accept， 因为会让公司更好。
Now let me talk about your perspective then toward the industry, because you're once quoted as saying that this industry, the media industry, you can't make a great fortune in providing shows to television stations.But over time, you have, or do you feel that you've created a great fortune?
I'm rich, of course. 但是 rich 不光是 pocket money 啊，我觉得 rich 是人生的 experience. I'm very, very rich 在人生经验方面，对我的行业，我觉得它是个有趣的行业，然后它是个 rich and famous， 它是个 celebrity， 它是有很多名名利利。在这个行业里面，它很多真的东西，有很多假的东西，所以对我来讲真的很有趣。它是一个 huge reality show， 一个大的真人秀。每个人为了要变成 celebrity 啊，等等等等，我看了很多。台湾以前有一个讲法，我觉得蛮有趣的，就是台湾呢有一个 check balance， 有钱的人没有权，有权的人没有钱，哦，比如 government 没有钱 ，government officer 也没有钱。那像我们这做 media 人没有权
也没有钱
但是我们有 influence， 我们有影响力。我觉得那个 check balance 很有趣，所以我认为做媒体的人就像做个电视台，我要做一些节目是 marketing orientation 的，是市场导向，要 earn money， 我一方面我要有一些 ideal， 我一方面是 reality， 一方面我要有点 ideal， 要一点 dream， 我去 check balance 做事情。我说做媒体人应该要像这样子。
But you're now in Shanghai as a guest on this show of Chinese Idol. Of course, the show comes from Fremantle. You know, it's not an SMG show. SMG has bought the rights for the show. So how is the world coming together? What do you see as this industry is changing, whether it's in the States and Europe with Endemol, you know, Endemol coming up with great shows like The Voice, and then now in China. And no matter where it is, all of these shows are surfacing up, and you're playing a part of that.But I'm interested in how you've come from, as you said, the late 70s, early 80s. You've seen television develop, and you were able to do a lot of new and creative things that hadn't been done before. So where do you see this trend? Is it a linear or is it a cycle?
这是个很好的问题。我觉得现在中国去购买一些 copyrights, 像 X Factor 或者是 American Idol 或者 Voice, 这些节目到中国来，我觉得目前是好的。为什么呢？我觉得可以一下子在很短的时间之内让电视的工作人员的在技术方面 technical 方面一下子 boom 拉高到一个地方，灯光、收音、 production、 post production, 然后各方面可以一下子，拿中国梦之声来讲，它现场的 camera 这么多，它的收音的音轨很多，它是一个大的制作，它可以把一个 variety show 制作成像一个 drama, 所以它必须要有这么多的机器，这么多的 equipment, 然后拿回去做 post dubbing, 这是一个聪明做法，这是一个大制作的方法。台湾不一样，台湾做节目跟日本很多地方很像，就是他先把这种 storyboard 啊 script 全部都做好，然后就很精准的要去做，他因为他 cost 比较小，所以我觉得这是一个阶段。领导也允许去买一些所谓的 copyright 这些节目进来，然后可以让电视工作人员所以在技术面整个提升到一个地步。
As we're talking about the industry, as you're in some ways mirroring the West with shows where you buy the right, at what point will we see shows coming up from Taiwan or from the Chinese mainland or from Japan or from Korea? Companies in the West or TV stations will buy those rights. At what time will we see this switching places?
一个人他有 power, 就是他有所谓的话语权，就是他在一个社会上他讲话别人会听，那就是代表说他是有 power 的。那世界也是一样，世界任何地的 power 都决定在这个民族或者国家是不是强大了。我觉得欧美都知道很多人要学 Mandarin, 要学汉语了，所以你讲这个趋势是绝对有可能的。只是说在中国来讲，有没有 producer 开始想一些电视节目让欧美会觉得有趣的，有可能啊。是什么呢？因为现在整个的文化还是非常西方的嘛，啊，比如说你很多的 reality show 是选秀啊，或者是说像 MTV 的 reality show 是大家年轻人住在一个房间里面呐，啊，然后被拍啊，这个都是西方的文化。那西方文化现在还在整个世界里面，在 marketing 里面还是在做 leader, 可是随着时代变化，有可能改变呢，有可能改变某些东方的文化，啊，会变成一个 reality show。举例来讲，你们很喜欢。